There's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucify, lay behind a stone. You live to die, rejected. Hello, God bless you all in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank God for today, and we really thank God for the sun has been shining. And when I was coming today, I was speaking with the cab driver, and he just said that after all the months of cold weather, is a welcome change, and I pray that it will remain this way. I want it to become warmer, because he's still hoping a bit so that, you know, it doesn't change his mind, and then we'll go back to cold. But I pray that we'll go back to cold in the mighty name of Jesus. Today is a wonderful day, and every day is a wonderful day, because I always believe that every day is a day that the Lord has made. So today too is another day that the Lord has made. So today is a day of blessing in our lives, and today is equally a day of breakthrough in our lives. And we thank God for that. If you remember, we know that the Padova program is started yesterday. That's Padova in Italy. And I just spoke with Pastor briefly this morning so that, you know, he can still get on and do some more studying and so on and so forth. And we thank God for the program. We know that today is still going to be even greater than yesterday until the conclusion tomorrow. Padova has always been, you know, a wonderful outing. I've only been there once. I think that was 2 years ago. But yet, it has always been a great and a wonderful outing. And I know that this time around, there shall be testimonies as normal. After all, it's the program of our Lord Jesus Christ. And he does the miracles, and he does, you know, the healings in the lives of people. And I know that today, yesterday, today, and tomorrow, it shall going to be a glorious time in the presence of the Lord. And I just want to remind us, too, of our Passover night coming up on the 26th of April. That is next week, Friday. Just make a date with that program. It's always a wonderful time. It's a time of Passover. And I know that as you come, you will not be disappointed in the mighty name of Jesus. So it's next week. So it's just about 6 days' time. And that's be the program. And it was today when I was thinking about it. I think I was talking with my daughter. And she said, is it next week that's Passover night? I said, yeah, next week. And I realized that April has gone. When did we enter April? When did we enter April? And April is gone. You find out that the days are really moving fast. And we need to make sure that our days are not wasted, that every day of our lives shall be useful in one way or the other, that will not while away our time. Because I don't know if it's that the time is moving faster or just that, I don't know. But let me tell you that it was just like yesterday, we entered 2013, and now we are heading towards the middle of the month, the middle of the year. And once you get to the middle of the year, that's it. Everybody begins to think about Christmas again, because once it's July, August, the next day you enter the Ember months, and everybody begins to prepare for Christmas. I don't want a situation where any of us will get towards the middle of the year and begin to ask ourselves, what have we achieved? Even if you have not yet achieved something, at least the ball should have started rolling. At least you should have started having a direction about which, direction you're heading to. It will be so sad that by July, August, people are still looking at themselves and they have not achieved anything. Things have not changed. There's nothing that is going on in their lives. I hope that this year is not going to be a year like that. And that is my prayer in the mighty name of Jesus. My prayer is that this year shall really be a year of change in the lives of each and every one of us. If you remember that this year, 2013, is the year of the Spirit, that means anything can happen. It depends on who you're holding on to faster. Or strongly, if you are holding on to God, hold on to God with all your might and with all your power, and follow Him and follow Him through. And whatever it is He directs you to do, you do. And I can assure you that at the end of the day, you will thank God that you did. Praise the Lord. So just before we go ahead, I just ask my sister to say hello to those of you who are out there and speak a word into your lives.
In the name of Jesus. Good afternoon, viewers. We welcome you once again to Jesus Sanctuary Ministries Hour. We thank God for your lives, and we thank God for today. Just like Pastor Mrs. Souza said, hold on to God. The word of God in Proverbs 35, it says that the word of God is pure, and he's a shield unto him that trusted in him. Therefore, whatever be your circumstance, whatever be your situation, try and align yourself with the word of God that actually identifies that problem or situation in your life. And hold on to that word, because it shall never lie. In Jesus' name. God bless you as you listen and as you watch. In Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Today, I'll just go straight into what we have today. But there's somebody who's looking at me. And today, this is your song. Victorious. Yes, we are victorious. Glory be to God, who has given us victory. Victory, we are victorious. Yes, we are victorious. Glory be to God, who has given us victory. Victory, we are victorious. Yes, we are victorious. Glory be to God, who has given us victory. Victory, we are victorious. Yes, we are victorious. Glory be to God, who has given us victory. We're giving glory to God because the victory is not as a result of our own power. The Bible says that by strength shall no man prevail. It's not by power, it's not by might, but it's by the Holy Spirit of God. And that is why we have victory in every situation. And of course, can't talk about victory without talking about battle. It is when you go through a battle that you now talk about whether somebody is a victor or the vanquished. But we know that for every battle we go through, we shall what? Emerge victorious. So we can't talk about victory without talking about what? Battle. And life is a battle. I'm telling you, life is a battle. I don't know what happened today. I don't know why I just started going through. I just found out that there was so much emails in my inbox from 2006. 2006, there was some not limited. So Yahoo was telling me that my my account was full. So and I said, okay, let me start. And I started from, the present ones. And I said, okay, no, let me start from 2006. Oh, my God, there was some... Sometimes, it's good to go back. There were some things which I was very, very interesting. And somebody sent an email. I was telling Pastor, why are you talking about deaths and battle? And why do you keep on shouting on the air? look, I couldn't stop laughing. I said, what that was? I think the person said it, I thought 2007. I couldn't stop laughing. Then the answer that pastor gave was really good. He now told me that, look, that one of the reasons why he shouts is because he stammers, so he has to speak in force so that the words will come out clear. That's number one. And then number two, that life is a battle that we battle every day. So you have to keep on talking about battles and death and this and that, because every day is a battle. So the man now replied again and I said, keep on shouting, keep on screaming, you're my best guy. I don't care anymore. You've always been my number one. So I kept on laughing. I said, it's good to go back to some of these things, because, you know, I was just eliminating and reading some, like, all these emails.
You can't eliminate
No, I didn't. I just kept it. So life is a battle. You know, life is a battle. Every day is a battle. But God will always give us what? Victory. And the reason why God allows battles, because sometimes we say, oh, why can't these problems all go? You know, once one problem is solved, it's like before you can rest for as long as you want, there's another one looming. And you begin to wonder, when will all these things stop? But as far as you're alive in this world, I want to tell you, there will always be battles. We should not complain about the battles, but we should put our trust and our faith in God, knowing fully well that God has given us victory. The Bible says that we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. So that means that you're sure that when you're entering into that world, into that battle, you don't do what? Win that battle. Even in the book of Ephesians from chapter 6, if you read from, I think, verse 10 down, it said that we wrestle not against what? Flesh and blood. He didn't say we may wrestle. He said it is ordained that we wrestle. But the explanation there is that it's not flesh and blood, but what? Principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, and spiritual wickedness in high places. It's a wrestling match. It's a wrestling match, and we must do what? We must battle in it, whether we like it or not. But as the song says, we are what? Victorious. We know, because Jesus Christ has won the ultimate battle on the cross of Calvary. And in the name of Jesus, we must what? We must conquer. In the name of Jesus. I think there's a song that goes like that. I can't remember. In the name of Jesus, we must conquer. How does it even start?
We are soldiers,
soldiers of the cross. In the name of Jesus, we shall conquer. So you're a soldier, we are all soldiers. We are soldiers of the cross. In fact, in the book of, I think, 1 Timothy, it talks about we being what? Soldiers. I think 1 Timothy 4, that we are what? Soldiers. And what do soldiers do? They fight. Soldiers are not just there to be, you know, going window shopping or eating pounded jam every morning, afternoon, and night. So they go through battle. That is the reason. To battle, to defend, and to do what? To equally be offensive as well. So the soldiers are there to defend the country, and when there's need to do what? To fight against those that are coming in, they fight against it. So they're both defensive and offensive. Spiritually, we are what? We are defensive and what? Offensive. So we are soldiers, soldiers of the cross. We are soldiers, you two are soldiers, soldiers of the cross. In the name of Jesus, we must conquer. I don't know so well, so don't mind if I'm not. Well, it just came to me. So in the name of Jesus, we must what? Conquer. Not in our name, not in our power, not in our strength. So whatever battles you are facing, I want to encourage you that you must conquer. You must overcome. One of the ways you can keep yourself up is when you remember the battles that God has fought for you before, and the victories and the testimonies. Then you go into the new battles knowing that God is going to give you victory. In fact, it's as you're going to battles that you begin to win over, you know,
territories.
When Hitler was fighting, he was conquering nations and taking over.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it was true war. When Iraq invaded Kuwait, isn't it to annex it to Iraq? Yeah. So we will conquer, we will gain what? Territories and overcome the enemy in Jesus' name. So we're still going to go back to the conclusion of Thursday's message, which was investment opportunities. And we are talking about investment in the biblical world manner, not concerning the world. The investments of the world, they are determined by what? They are controlled by economic factors, political factors. Just because of this bombing in Boston, it has already affected the what? The shares. Anything that happens, it goes up and down. But that which is based on the Bible, we can never go up and down. And we talked about winning souls, we talked about investing in widows, and we talked equally too about investing in the destitute, the ex-convicts, and so on and so forth. And today we are going to, I just mentioned some few things that we didn't really go into much, but there's something I want to say, and it has to do with even prayer. Prayer is an investment. You know, we talk about being proactive. You don't wait until something happens before you begin to do what? Pray against what? The enemy. Because we have an enemy that is real and that is always out. The Bible says in the book of 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, that our adversary goes about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he what? Devour. And God said that we should be what? We should be sober, we should be what? Vigilant. Because he's going about looking for, so we know that Satan is going about with his cohorts, looking for an open door to come in order to do what? To attack. So you do not even wait until it happens. You start early to begin to pray. If you are praying against the spirit of death, you don't need to wait until death comes knocking on the door. You start early. You start early praying against poverty. You start early praying against failure. You start early praying against shame, as the spirit of God will do what? Lead you. There are some of us too who are enjoying the benefits of what? Of prayers of before. You may not even know it. But there are prayers you have prayed. That's why the thing that happened, you may not even know where your prayer is landing. You may not know where it's landing, but it is landing somewhere. And prayer is what? An investment. It is a serious investment that will reap a lot in your life. But I want to share this testimony, you know, I read about concerning this issue before I go into the next, you know, topic, because I mean there's so many places where the Bible talks about prayer. In the 1 Thessalonians 5:18, it says pray without ceasing. In the book of Luke chapter 18 verse 1, it says that men ought always to pray and not to what? And not to faint. Jesus separated himself several times and sought the face of God in prayer. But there was I was reading, I think it was the autobiography of Maurice Cerullo, and he was talking about how, because he was actually a Jew, but he was orphaned at a young age, and he was moved from one orphanage to the other. He said by the time he was 16, he was, you know, kicked out, because I mean, at 16, as far as they're concerned, you go and stay on your own. And he was not talking about how he became born again, but there was something that he said. He said that one day he was praying and God gave him a revelation. He said in that revelation, he saw a mighty house in heaven. It was decorated with precious stones and all sorts and whatever. So as he was looking at the house, God was telling him, that is your house. So he was just admiring the house. They say that the next thing God showed him, God showed him another house, exactly like his own, but it was times two, both in size, both in decoration and everything. So he was saying that he was just saying to himself, I wonder which great man of God, again, that has, because by then God had already been using him around the world. So he was like trying to think, which is the great man of God that is, you know, has done more than him, that has that house. So he now asked God, he said, who has this house? Then God showed him one lady. I'm sure the lady must be dead now, because when he was writing that book, the woman was about in her 70s. Okay. And it was a lady in his church. I only met her once. One day when she, you know, when after service, she just came and, you know, shook his hand, like people were coming to shake hands with him. And she just said, oh, I've been praying for you. I keep on praying for you. And he just, like, you know, acknowledged, oh, thank you. So he said that he became so angry. He said, God, how can, with all he has done, going around the world, preaching the gospel, the crusades and everything, what is this woman? She's not even a worker in the church. How come she has double what I have, times two? And God told her that the reason why she has time is that whatever you are today is that woman. She said that they have not killed you is that woman. That you have not fallen is that woman. That the times I wanted to deal with you is that woman. That the power, the open doors and everything is that woman. That she made you her project, her prayer project. That she doesn't pray for any person apart from you. That day and night she's praying and crying and fasting for you. That there's no other person, no person again. It is you, morning, noon, and night, that she keeps on calling before me. So whatever you have, she'll have double. He said that was a humbling moment for him. And that should be a humbling moment for us, because a lot of, the Bible says there will be surprises in heaven. Mm-hmm. Some of you who think that you there's nothing you have to offer, you'll be surprised what you have to offer. Mm-hmm. The woman made this man of God her project. That's what God says. He made her, so morning, noon, and night, she will not pray for any other person, just him. She was a widow. That was her prayer. Why don't you make somebody your project? Instead of any time a man of God has a problem, everybody will know and begin to spread news. Instead of praying, listen up. When she has a problem, everybody, hey, did you hear what happened? This one, that one. Mix just one person. I didn't say two, one person. Because whatever that is happening in that person's life, times two will be your own. So prayer is an investment, a big investment. And as you're praying for somebody, you're equally praying for yourself. Once you're praying for somebody, you're praying for yourself. A lot of the times we find it difficult to pray for other people. But if it's our own self, there is this prayer point. You're praying, oh my, yourself, then you may remember your husband, your wife, your children. You just center it around. But to pray for somebody who may not even acknowledge you, who you may never meet here on earth, is only in heaven. It takes a lot of what? Grace and humility and love and compassion for you to make somebody your project. So prayer is what? An investment. Don't look at yourself and think, what do I have? My sister, I think, just can you go to, there's a particular scripture that, you know, I want us to read. I think it's, it just occurs to me now. So I'm not too sure. There's a particular scripture. I can't remember where it is, but I will soon find it, because I think it's in the book of Matthew. Go to Matthew 25, you know. Matthew 25. And I might find it by God's grace. Matthew 25 from 14. Because it just...
Shall I?
I'll just be reading it.
Okay, I should start reading
it. I'll just start reading it.
Matthew 25 from 14, verse 14.
Yes.
For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country.
Okay, yeah, that's it, yeah.
Who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey.
You can stop there. Okay. You find out that a lot of us, I think, either we don't recognize what we have. Like when I was given the, you know, definition of investment, I said, invest, and you know, to invest talks about using your resources and putting it into something, into a project, into somebody's life, into a situation, in order to receive returns. The talent and ability God gave you is a resource. It may not be as much as another person's own, but God does not expect you to, you know, do as much as somebody who has more than you. He gave one 5, he gave one 2, if he gave one. We will not read everything, it was a long passage. But the one that he gave 5 talents, he came back with what? 5 extra. He now made it 10. The one that has 2 talents, he came back with 2 extra and he made it 4. God was not expecting that the person he gave 2 to come back with 10. He knows what he gave him. And what he gave him was just to give him 100% return on his investment. In fact, the one that was given 5, if he came back with 9 talents, he would have fallen short of the mark. Even though he has 9, another person has what? 4. He would have fallen short, because God expects what? 100% return in what he has invested in you. But the point I want to make is the person that had 1 talent. There are a lot of people who are like that. And there was something that the Spirit of God was telling me. He said that, do you know why some people hide their talent? It's because they look at it and they feel that God should change them. You gave this person this, you gave this person this, you gave me this person this. What do you want me to do with this little one you have given me? And that is actually a point. People say, what? I don't really have. When people say, what do I really have? I can't do what that person is doing. I can't do what that person is doing. How about the one you can do? So a lot of people despise the little that God has given them. And you're wasting your time wishing you had the one that had 5. Not knowing that to whom much is given, much is what? Expected. The greater the talent, the greater the gift you have, the greater the call of God upon your life, the greater the expectation from God, which unfortunately not everybody is able to fulfill. But the lower you have, the least expectation. If you can get 100% return on the little God has given you, you have passed. So some people look down on what God has given. Some of people are unhappy or angry with the one that they feel is too small. Even in the church, there are positions you're put in. You feel, why wasn't I made a head of department? Why wasn't I made what? A minister? Why am I just still ordinary? Maybe your work is even just to clean toilets. Not even, to at least, if you're singing in choir, they will see you with your uniform and your beautiful voice. This one, your cleaning toilet, and you're despising where you are. Why must you despise where you are? If God wanted to put you in a certain place, He would have given you the talents to be there. Every area in our lives, something is needed. Because even you that may be cleaning toilet, you think it's not important. Okay, the day they're not clean toilet, church toilet for 1 week, you will know how important. So don't look down. Don't look down. What you may not think is important is very, very what? Important. Some of us, we just feel that we don't have what it takes to do anything. Or it's too small. So why bother? You go and hide your talent. Let those who have 5 talents and 20 talents do the work of God. What God has put in you is what God will use to do what? To promote you. The Bible says that a man's gift maketh way for him and brings him before what? Great men. What is in you? When you invest it out, when you put it into something, it will cause people to do what? To notice it. And there are people who need what you have. It may be only one thing, but that one thing you have, people what? Need it. So why hide it? I don't know who I'm talking to. You just go to church and you leave. There's opportunities all around us. If only we will open our eyes and use what we have that God has given us for the benefit of mankind. Some of us are waiting until we win lottery before you do anything. That little you have, you can do something with it. Some of us are waiting, I'm just waiting until all the children leave home so I will be free to do the work of God. You'll be surprised once they now leave home. If it's not they're telling that your father is too old and he's now sick, so you have to be looking after him. No time again. There's never any time. You create the time. You remove other things and have priorities. Because you can keep on saying after, and after will never come. And you will end up taking what God has given you, hiding it, keeping it there. And when you come before God, what will you tell him? You will talk to him like this man. You know, what he said was quite funny. He said, I think he said in verse 24, he said, then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art a hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not strawed. Can you imagine? Giving excuses and, depicting his master as a hard man to justify him not using his talent. Said, and I was afraid and went and hid our talent in the earth. Lo, take that your own, that is your own. You gave me one, so you take it back. You want me to go and suffer. And after suffering, I will get 2. And I will give it back to you. No. But what did God call him in verse 20? He said, his Lord answered and said, thou wicked and slothful what? Servant. You're wicked and what? So God considers it wickedness when you hide what he has what? Given. We hide it and we're looking at other people as if to say that, these ones are the lucky ones. No. You have something that you can invest. Everybody has something in them that they can do what? They can invest for future, for not only in this earth, but what? In heaven. Unless you're not on your way to heaven. But I believe we're all of us on our way to heaven. Praise the Lord. So I just want to speak to, concerning the poor. I mentioned that because that just occurred to me too, because we have what it takes to do one something or the other. It depends on you to decide whether you're going to use it. Like I said, I quoted that scripture. If I'm my sister, please read it. Sometimes when you quote scripture offhand, some people think that maybe you made it up. So it's always good to...
The one in Psalm.
The one in Proverbs.
Okay.
Proverbs 19 verse... Sorry, Proverbs 18 verse 16.
Proverbs 18:16.
Yes, my sister.
A man's gift maketh room for him and bringeth him before great men.
A man's gift. So that gift, that talent, that resource, because your gift is a what? Is a resource. He says, it maketh room for you and bringeth you before what? Great men. Those who come before great men, they don't have two heads. There's something there. If you don't invest it, then it's what? A waste of time. It's only what you use that can yield returns. If physically now in the earth, if you don't put your money in a savings account, you can't, you know, yield any what? Profit. So if you don't use what God has given you, you don't expect any returns. Some of us just want this person do this for me, that person do this for me, this one pray for me, this one do that. But you're not making an effort to look inward and say, is there anything in me that I can use to the glory of God that will cause God to open doors for me, that will cause favor of God and man to come upon me, that will cause me to come before what? Great men. Joseph could have looked down on his gift as if, you know, investing it in people. When the butler and the baker told him his dream, he could have just said, what is the point interpreting their dream? He could have pretended he can't, I don't have the ability. I'd ignore them. Daniel could have ignored the king's command. He could have. Some of us do that. We know we have the ability. We don't put ourselves forward. We just stay back. Let another person. Who is that other person you're waiting for? Can't another person do it? As if to say people answer another person. Why can't you do it since you have the ability to do it? But it was that very thing that he did that cost, after 2 or 3 years, when Pharaoh dreamt, the butler came and said, there was a young man in prison that interpreted my dream. And that is, and what he said came to pass exactly. And they called him. Mm. But if you had hidden it,
yes.
Like some of you, that's what you do. There are people who have come out to sing, and somebody has spotted them in the church, and that's it. And that's it. There are people who, maybe as they're cleaning the toilet or something or the other, they have done something for somebody. Somebody has picked them up. You don't know who God is going to use to bless you. You don't know who God is going to use to draw you out from where you are and put you where you're going to be. So make sure that any opportunity you have to show forth. It's only what you show forth that can yield. What you don't show forth can't yield anything. If I don't put seed in the ground, it's not going to grow. If I keep it in a container, it will remain there. If I myself, please go to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 9. From verse 9.
Okay,
verse 10, sorry.
Now, 2 Corinthians chapter 9 from verse 10.
Yes.
Now, he that ministereth seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food, and multiply your seed sown, and increase the fruits of your righteousness.
So the operating word here is that, multiply your seed sown. God cannot multiply what you have hidden. Just like the man with the 5 talents, it was multiplied because he did what? He used it. It now became multiplied. But the one that hid his own, there was no way to multiply it. So God can't multiply that your gift if you have decided to hide it. Some have the ability to intercede very well. Why don't you join your intercessory team? Some have good voices. You sit down in the crowd. Some have the ability to help people. God did not bless you financially just to be feeding fat on your own. You can go out of your way to do what? Certain things. Some know how to, you know, all these things are what? Resources. God has given us everything. The Bible said that he has blessed us with spiritual gifts, with everything that we need. It's all in us. You need to discover it. I realize it's a resource that can take you forward, that can promote you, that can take you to the next level in life. So I just want to talk to you about I wanted to talk about investing in the poor, but I mentioned it briefly last Thursday. But myself, I wanted to just read Proverbs 19:17.
Proverbs 19:17.
Yes.
He that hath pity upon the poor lendeth unto the Lord, and that which he had given will he pay him again.
So can you imagine? He said that he that hath pity on the poor lendeth. So if you're lending to God, when God is paying you back, you know what it means for God to owe you? It means when he's paying you back, he will pay you back more. It's like with your children. You may be looking for, you know, change. I said, okay, does anybody have maybe one pound coins or 50, you know, pence coins? And they'll maybe, you know, search their bag. Somebody will come up with one or two. When you're paying them back, will you give them coins? You won't now. You may just bring out even a 10-pound note and give them. You as a parent, because you won't have time to begin to look for your children once you owe them. My daughter came back, when was it? I think it was it on Wednesday. She now told me, Mom, you owe me 80 pence. I said, with everything I gave you, you're actually telling me. That was the first thing. As I just entered, when we came up first, as I just entered the house and she greeted me, as I greeted me, the next thing was, Mom, you owe me 80 pence. I said, children, do they ever owe you people? They don't owe you anything. I said, 80 pence, you're disturbing me this night. But that's children for you. And there's no way I'm going to begin to look for 80p to give her. You may just look for 5 pounds, so yet you take. So there's no way you can owe God, and God will even pay you back what He will give. I mean, the money you're owing Him is too small now, so He will give you more. He said that He who has pity on the poor lendeth to God, and He will repay him back. Because God does not owe people. He's not like some of us. When credit card bill now comes, He begin to calculate how long before the last date. I will wait until the last date before I go and pay. Because of the way things are. I said, if I begin to pay everything at the same time, my bank account will crash. So when they get tired of...
You stagger the payment.
You stagger the payment. That's good. You stagger it. Because if you do everything at once, you're going to be in trouble. I will wait till they will send me first reminder, second reminder. When they last time tell me that if you don't pay, I say, okay, time has reached to pay. Let me, you want to first of all pay those who are disturbing you. Those who are not disturbing you, you wait. Because this country, bills, oh my God. Sometimes when you're paying the bills, you'll be angry. It's like all the money you have, you're paying this, you're paying that, you're paying this. You'll be writing check. You'll be, what is this? So God will always do it. Pay back what He owes. And if He said that if you have pity on the poor, you're lending to Him, is a very strong statement. Do things for those who are poor around you. Do things for those who are poor around you. And like I said last Thursday, poor is not only when somebody is financially poor. There are those who are poor, so some people are like outcasts in the society. There are some people who are always being bullied, either because of their size or one thing or the other. Why don't you be what? A help unto them. Why don't you be a source of encouragement unto them? That is a resource to invest in the life, and God will not forget that. There's some of us, you get encouragement from so many places. Why? Because you're a person that encourages. If you don't encourage people, when you need encouragement, you won't see it. That's the truth of the matter. If you don't love people, then when you want love, you're not going to get it. And that is just life for you. Praise the Lord. But one, I'm going to stop with that because we will still open the lines. I'll talk about our parents. My sister, please, can you go to Ephesians chapter 6, 1 to 3? Because investing in your parents is a blessing that you can't quantify. Ephesians 6, 1 to 3.
Ephesians 6 from verse 1.
Yes.
Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth.
He said, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is what? Right. Honor thy father and thy mother, which is the first commandment with what? Promise. Even the ones God was talking concerning himself, he didn't attach promise to it. But the one where it comes to honoring your father, and this is the first commandment that is directed towards human beings. The first five have to do with God. From six down has to do with what? My man. And this is the first one. And it's honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long. So this is the first commandment with what? With promise. Unfortunately, the world today is like being disobedient to parents is the norm. Both young and adults, people don't have any regard for their parents. What I want to say is that when you become a parent yourself, that is even when you begin to appreciate the sacrifice that your parents made. You may think you're appreciating it when you're single. This is when you get married and see what you have to, the investment. Children are expensive now.
Very.
Children are expensive. You may eat once or twice a day just because that's to eat. Mm. Children, they can eat 20 times a day. Yes, you will see it in them. Because they're so active. As they just finish eating, they will run it out of their system. One day I had to ask my son, do you have a hole in your stomach? He said, mommy, I don't know. After eating, I'm still feeling. I said, because active. They're active. You buy clothes for them this time around. In the next 2 months, you have outgrown it. You, the one you bought 10, 15 years ago, you bring it out and it's still okay. The reason why you may not wear is maybe you want to give it out or something like that. Children are expensive. Then the education, this and that. Then you now begin to understand the sacrifices, because there are things you have had to go without so that you give the best to your children. Then you now begin to realize what your parents did, the sacrifices they made, and then you don't bother about them. You don't care about them. You don't do anything about them. Some of you, your parents had to borrow to send you to school. You can equally borrow to be a blessing to your father and your mother. I've done it before, not once, not twice. Because as far as I'm concerned, why would my dad have headache at his age? Let me carry the headache myself. Let me do the borrowing and begin to think about how I'm going to pay back, not him. Make sacrifice for your parents. Go out of your way. Don't only look at when it's convenient. And like I said, parents are not only those who give birth to you biologically. They are people who have been like fathers and mothers to you. They have sacrificed for you. They have been there for you. What have you done for them? I hope this word has touched somebody today, and I want you to think about the other things. But because of time and, you know, to keep in character with the program, will open the lines, and maybe you have a contribution, maybe you have, you know, maybe you don't even agree with what we are saying. Well, God will convince you in Jesus' name. But you are free. You are free to make your contribution. You are free to ask a question or the other, or maybe there's something you want to share. You are free to do so. And God will bless you as you do so, in the mighty name of Jesus. So while we're waiting for the engineers to set everything in motion, I just want to remind us again that the part of our program is on. So even if you missed yesterday, don't miss today and don't miss tomorrow. And of course, pastors announced that for now there will be no one nights with the Holy Ghost. For the meantime, we're looking for a permanent place. Of course, a permanent place is cheaper and it is better. And why we want a permanent place is, at least apart from that one night with the Holy Ghost, by God's grace, we may have, you know, services or one thing or the other. So by God's grace, in the next few months we'll be able to get a place in Antwerp, and then we will resume in the mighty name of Jesus. So that is that for that. And remember, Sunday, I think tomorrow is a marathon, but that shouldn't stop you from going to church. Find a route today, that you alternate routes that can make you come to church. Don't avoid or abandon the household of God because of marathon. Marathon is not enough. Oh, we have a caller on the line. Hello, Christiana from London. Hello?
I'm the financial breakthrough. Hello?
Hello? Is that Christiana from London?
Yeah.
Yes, go ahead.
I need a financial breakthrough, please.
Do you want me to give you the money? You said you need a financial breakthrough. You get financial breakthrough by giving, my sister. My preaching hadn't to do with me talking about money. I was talking about other things, but still, money too is an investment. If you don't give, you cannot what? Get. The Bible says, give and it shall be what? Given unto you. You don't get financial breakthrough by prayer. So learn to give. Give to your church, give to the poor around you, give to your family members, give to your parents, and God will bless you in Jesus' name. Hello, Clinton from London.
Hello. Yes, please, I'm very happy for the teaching I have today.
We thank God, my brother.
It changed my life, and you know, warm my spirit up, and also, you know, there's a place you mentioned in the scripture.
Yes.
That said, he must be what or since or whatever. That yeah. Once you give, you receive.
Yes.
And somebody that God gave talent.
Yes.
Let him use that talent.
Yes.
For faith.
Yes.
And there are people that have talent, they don't discover their talent.
Yeah.
Because the kind of environment they are.
Yeah.
Or because of things they are seen through.
Yes.
No matter how condition, I know that your talent will not be hidden in you.
Yes.
And also the prayer you said and the ministry.
Yes.
Yeah, Jesus Sanctuary Ministry. I would like to know where you worship as well and know the postcode and the address and the place. And let me one day visit the church as well.
Oh, no problem. And they will soon put the address on the screen. They can put the address on the screen so that my brother can see it. It's 25-27 Ruby Street, off Old Kent Road. But it will appear on the screen, on the screen, or you can go to our website and you see the address there as well. God bless you, my brother. Hello, hello, somebody from Nottingham. I'm sorry, I didn't catch your name.
Yeah,
Dumebi. Oh yes, go ahead, my. Is it a woman or a man?
Good afternoon.
Oh, good afternoon, my sister. Please go ahead.
I'm so happy to speak to you. You and your husband, you've been a blessing.
Amen.
Yes, ma'am. You were talking about honoring our parents.
Yes.
Yeah, I know that it's really important, but sometimes, because of one's bitter experience, you know, you sometimes one finds it difficult to do that. So in that case, where one has been in this country and your money and everything, you've been honoring them, and they pay you back with evil. Maybe one of them.
Yes.
How do one do it anymore? Because sometimes you just want to be on your own. You don't want to, because of the bad experience one has got. So that's what I just want to ask. Well, how can one go about it?
Well, my sister,
the more you honor them, the more they hurt you.
My sister, the thing is that I think somebody called you and mentioned something like that on Thursday. And I'll tell you the same thing. You know, we don't do things for people because of how nice they will react. In fact, if you think about it, most of the time, a lot of people show ingratitude, no matter how much you do for them. And Satan attacks like that way in order to stop people from giving or stop people from helping people, knowing that that is where their blessings will be. The Bible says, honor your father and your mother. Honor them because God said so. Don't honor them because they are good or they are nice or they are wonderful. If you begin to look at the way some parents behave, you never honor them. Honor them because that, the Bible said that is right. Not because they are good. The Bible never said that honor parents that are wonderful. Just honor them. The only thing is that when you want to give your parents anything, pray over it that they will not use it against you. And you give it to them. And God will honor that in Jesus' name. Hello, Rosemary from Colchester.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Is that Rosemary? Or is that Friday? Hello?
I can hear you, ma. Can you hear me?
Yes. Are you Friday?
Yeah, I'm Friday.
Please. Okay, I'm sorry. I think I must have lost Rosemary. Please go ahead.
All right, ma. I just called to appreciate your effort, you and your husband, Pastor,
amen,
with those efforts, because of what you have been preaching on the TV each time I watch you.
Yes.
And may the Lord continue to enrich you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Because one thing people don't understand about this God's blessing is they always believe that blessing is only money.
Of course not.
But they believe that blessing is always being financial blessing.
Of course not.
One thing I really want to really just to a little bit contribute in this program.
Yes.
Blessing. Good health is blessing.
Of course.
When you have good health, you are not sick.
Yes.
God has blessed you.
Of course.
When you have good wife, when you have good children.
Yes.
Those ones are blessings.
Of
even
course.
Even sleeping and waking up, these are blessings.
Of course.
It's not a financial blessing. We think about financial. That is why what we are supposed to even ask from God, whenever we pray, we ask for God to give us his heart desire.
Yes.
God to give us wisdom. When he gives us wisdom, every other thing will be added.
Of course.
So I don't know why a lot of us do God, because we don't force God to bless us. Anytime we pray to God,
yes,
for my own little bit understanding, anytime we pray to God, God knows exactly what he needs to bless us with. Just that we have in our keys now.
Yes.
My kid can come back from school and say, Daddy, I want to buy a car. I know that is not the particular time for me to buy a car.
Of course not. Of course not.
What he needs at that particular time, that is what I have to give to him.
Mm-hmm.
So we should try and know much about these things. That is why I don't listen to many. I'm not trying to be against a lot of pastors that preach in the TV.
Yes.
But what I want us to understand is we should seek ye the kingdom of God first, so that every other thing
shall be added unto us. Thank you very much, my brother, for that contribution. It's wonderful because once people hear bless or give, everybody thinks about money. It's not good health. There are people who have money, but they are sick. They will rather give out that their money than to remain sick. So health, good health is a blessing. Wonderful kids, wonderful wife, wonderful husband, they are blessings as well. Yes, hello, caller. Hello? Hello? Jeremiah from Holland.
No, this is Rosemary from
Rosemary from Calcutta. Yes, sorry for keeping you waiting. Please go ahead.
That's okay. I just want to bless God for the good job you and your husband are doing.
Amen, my sister.
You talked about talents.
Yes.
And that's a wake-up call for me to
use
the many talents that the Lord has given me.
Yes.
You also talked about honoring your parents.
Yes.
And that is a good point. Thank you very much for that.
Yes.
And I want to just encourage you with the gentle spirit that you have.
Amen.
Do come across very simply.
Amen.
Straight to the heart. I was watching you with my daughter.
Yes.
And she was like, yes, I understand what she's saying, Mom. True. I want to encourage you.
Amen.
You're doing a good work and the good Lord will bless you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you very much, my sister. Thank you for those words of encouragement. And my prayer too is too that the presence of God will never depart from your home. And that the favor of God will continue to be with you and your family in Jesus' name. Amen. Hello, caller. Hello. I thought I saw somebody, Jeremiah, on the line. I'm not too sure. Hello. There was a name. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, please, who's calling?
It's Nena from Milton Keynes.
Okay, go ahead, my sister.
Good morning, Pastor.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Yes.
I'm just calling to appreciate you.
Yes, ma'am.
To tell you that you and your husband is doing a great work, you know, for the worldwide.
Amen.
Anytime I listen to you, you know, I feel so happy.
Amen.
Very joyous because you are so natural, you know, in the way you dish out your word of God and, you know, you make a great impact on me. And I know it's so with so many people out there in the world.
Amen.
So I've been taking time to pray for you all the time.
Thank you, ma'am.
God will continue to elevate you.
Amen.
Make you make more people to make heaven.
Amen.
You know, the same thing with your husband in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I promise I'll be praying for you all the time.
Thank you, ma'am.
God will uplift you and bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
One day I'll find time and come along to your church. And see you face to face.
That would be wonderful. That would be wonderful.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma. And God bless you and keep you as well. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hello, Grace from London. We only have 1 minute, so please, you have to be fast. Hello, Grace from London.
Hello, good afternoon, ma.
Good afternoon, my sister.
Yeah, I've been listening to your sermon, and I'm very happy.
Amen.
And I'm asking you to please pray for my family.
Okay, I'll pray for you because of time. Father, I pray that as your daughter answers Grace, let the grace of God be with her and her family in the mighty name of Jesus. Grant her the grace and enablement to stand firm as a child of God. Grant her the grace to be the person you want her to be in Jesus' name. Our time is up, but God is always with you. Remember that tomorrow is church. Don't allow tomorrow's marathon to keep you. Start now to look forward, a way that you can take. The Bible, God makes us understand that our Sunday, the day of the Lord, is a day we should be in the presence of God. And God will bless you indeed in the mighty name of Jesus. God bless you and God keep you. And see you next time in Jesus' name. Amen.